The first, we don't sit down in the midst of quiet solitude and listen, just listen. We don't do that often enough. And two, we don't stand up and say to the world, that's enough. No more. This stops here. We don't do that often enough. On one hand, we live in a world of noise. How can we hear God speak to us if we don't find moments of quiet? And on the other hand, we live in a world of bullies. How can things possibly improve if we don't stand up to them? Proverbs is a book of short sayings. Consecutive verses often are not connected at all. If you tried to read through Proverbs and you read just one page, you'd probably see a minimum of 10 themes. Just short little verses, one after the other, aren't always connected. But the verses that I read for you today is an example of the opposite. It all stayed on one subject. Good friend, don't forget all I've taught you. Take to heart my teachings. They'll help you live a long, long time, a long life lived full and well. Trust God from the bottom of your heart. Don't try to figure everything out on your own. Listen for God's voice in everything you do and everywhere you go. He's the one who will keep you on the right track. Don't assume that you know it all. Run to God. Run away from evil. Where do you go to listen to God? Do you have a place? Scripture is a good place, but it's not the only place. Listening to music is a good place for some, but not for everyone. It's a good place for me. Anything Pina has put on record, I listen to. I love her music, and it's a spiritual moment for me, but it's not for everyone. Helping someone out can also be a time when God can speak to us. We never discount that. But do you know what Jesus did when he most needed to speak with his Father? Where did he go? He went and sought out solitary places. A place of quiet. A place absent of competing voices. A place where the needs of the world fall silent for a moment or two. Today's text reminds us that God's voice can be found in all things and in all places. And I believe that. But the problem is that we aren't always listening for God's voice in all things and in all places. Here are the words that God spoke to the prophet, Jeremiah, chapter 7, verse 13. And God said to the prophet, while you were doing all of those things, I spoke to you again and again, but you would not listen. You see, I don't think God shouts so much as I think he whispers. Have you ever noticed that when someone is about to lose their voice, where'd she go? There we are. Maybe it's a cold that is setting in or laryngitis. But whenever someone is losing their voice, you lean in to listen to them, don't you? You have to in order to hear that voice speak. God's voice can get through to us anytime, any place. But I think the peace and quiet of solitude is most often a better place to hear God's voice. And what does God's voice sound like? A flash of insight, an idea that suddenly comes to you, a surge, an unexpected surge of conviction, a sensation of peace, a feeling of acceptance, an assurance of forgiveness, A renewed faith that God won't let you down. That's what God's voice sounds like. Those are the messages that God's voice conveys to us. When God speaks, He wants us to hear Him. You know how frustrating it is, we all do, when someone obviously isn't listening to you. It's frustrating, isn't it? I spoke to you again and again, God said to His beloved prophet, but you did not listen. I wouldn't want God to say that to me. I wouldn't want Peggy or anyone in our families to say that to me. I would not want you to say that to me. So where did you go to listen to God? Wherever that might be, I encourage us to go there. And maybe more often than we do. The opposite of listening, of course, is speaking. We do that a lot. But I strongly believe, and I bet you wouldn't expect a minister to say this, I strongly believe that we have in today's society become a people who are too nice and too timid. Too nice and too timid. Yes, a minister is saying that to his people. You're too nice! And along with that, too timid. If there's a time to be quiet so that you can hear the whisper of God, then there's also a time to be aware of and frustrated by the meanness, by the injustices in this world. We call such moments holy disturbances. Different people will have different things that disturb them. You'll recognize your own disturbances, things that push your hot button. They are those things that when you go home and you turn on television and you see something happening with the news, it hits you right here like a kick from a ninja warrior. And you think to yourself, that's just wrong. It's wrong. Or it's something that might happen in our own community. And you think to yourself, somebody needs to do something about that. Well, yes, somebody does. But it won't be somebody who is just too nice or too timid. Too often, we don't become a part of the solution. Why? Well, I might say the wrong thing, or I'm not even sure I can help, or no one's asked me to do anything yet, or come on, by myself, I can't fix this, or what can one person do anyway? And so we settle for doing nothing. And the more we do nothing, the less likely there's any chance of improvement. Chances are, if something is a holy disturbance for you, well, maybe it's a holy disturbance for God, too. Not always, but at least some of the time. But God, I assure you, has His own holy disturbances just as we do, and He will want us to be disturbed by them as well. Sometimes we're just too nice or too timid to take a stand. What are those things that push your hot buttons? They're not going to be identical to the person sitting by you, but what are those for you? What has to happen for you to express some kind of righteous indignation? What might be the issues for you to become willing to draw a line in the sand and to mean it? The other day, I took a stand. If there's anything I learned early in my ministry, it was don't use yourself as a positive example. Preachers should use themselves as negative examples, as what not to do. But I'm going to do the opposite of that this time, just so I can show you how easy it is to find moments in our lives where we have to take a stand. It came right at me. One of my hot buttons is when people are paid to be helpful to others, and then instead of being helpful, they choose to be a hindrance. I went to the hospital to see Jim and Babe. I pulled into the parking lot, and I saw a clergy parking. It had been 30 years since I had been at this hospital. And so I went right over, I parked right in clergy. It was very close to the hospital. I got out of the car, I put my driver's license in my pocket. I always do that when I go to a hospital and I'm not really familiar with all the might be asked of you. And I locked the car and I was walking away, and for some reason I turned around and looked at the car and I realized there's a sign off to the side that says clergy parking only, violators will be towed away. And I thought, who do I need to tell that I'm a clergy? I want that car to be there when I come out. So I looked around the parking lot and I saw a security guard. He was standing way at the opposite end. And so I walked all the way to him and I said, sir, I'm a United Methodist minister and I'm here to see a man who's been in a horrible wreck. I saw the clergy parking, that's where I pulled in. Is that okay? And can I park there? And he said, well, you have to show me that you are a minister. And I said, you know, we really don't have a card that proves that. What would that take? I don't have a card that says minister in good standing. And he said, well, you got a bulletin with your name on it? And I said, you know, it's Friday. I do have Sunday's bulletin with me. I even got my sermon. I walked all the way back to the opposite end of the parking lot. I got the bulletin and the sermon, and I took them over to him, and I held them out in front of him, but he wouldn't take them. And I said, here's the bulletin, here's my sermon. And he said, well, that's no proof. I said, well, that's what you just asked for. I said, here, look at this bulletin. You didn't look at it. And I turned to the back page where it says minister and then my name, pulled out my driver's license, and I said, see, it's one and the same person. And he said, that doesn't prove anything. I said, well, what do I need to do so that my car is here when I get out of the hospital? And he said, you need to go into the security office and register there and get a sticker. And I said, well, where is that security office? And he said, well, it's at the opposite end of the building. All I want to do is go see Jim and Babe. That's all I want to do. And I said, okay, but I can't prove to them any better than I was able to prove to you that I am an ordained United Methodist minister. How am I going to have any more success with them than I had not had with you? He said, give them $5. And I said, no. No. I came to you and asked you, is my car going to be here? Is it safe? I parked in clergy parking. Is that okay? You're the one who said, prove it. You're the one who said, bring me a bulletin. I brought you a bulletin and a sermon. You weren't going to look at either of them. But I showed you my name is on the bulletin. My name is on the driver's license. Now you tell me that if I go into the security office and I pay them $5, which will not prove that I am a clergy person. That doesn't prove anything. That they will give me a sticker. I said, no, I'm not going to do that. I said, you, sir, are someone who is standing out here trying to help people. You like to control people. And that needs to be said to you, sir. And then I said this, I'm going to go in and I'm going to see my couple inside that hospital. And I'm going to come out that door and I'm going to walk over to my car, which will be there and it will not be towed away, and I will not be carrying a sticker, and I will not have gone to a security office, and I will not have turned loose of $5 of my money, because I'm at this hospital once every 30 years, and in the next 30 years, I plan to be in heaven. And then I'm going to get in that car, and I'm going to drive out of this parking lot, and I am going to wave to you when I go, and what I will say as I leave this parking lot is, have a loving day. And he just stood there. Somebody stood up to him. They stood up to him. But they did it in a loving way. And I don't like to use myself as an example of having done it right. But somebody needed to take a stand. You run into that kind of stuff all the time. In our community, elsewhere, in the name of God, sometimes we have to stand up to injustices that are a lot worse than that one. Okay? That one's simple. That's minuscule. God not only calls us into moments of solitude where we go over and put ourselves in a quiet place where he can reach our heads and our hearts, but God sometimes speaks to us and says, this is your moment. Make a stand. Say yes, say no, but say what needs to be said. No, we're just too nice sometimes to do that. Whatever hits you in the middle of your stomach that sickens you, that makes you upset and angry at what's happening somewhere in the community or elsewhere, that's God's voice speaking to you. That's holy disturbance. I'm not here to promote anger or some kind of anxiety. I'm here to say there's already anger and anxiety out there in the world. You're the answer to it. You're the answer. Maybe it's the child next door to you that you know something is not right. Do you call that in, or do you not? Maybe it's the husband down the street. You know he's beating his wife, but she isn't going to call for assortment of reasons. What about you? Maybe it's the child in that neighborhood who just isn't getting the right kind of nourishment. When are you going to be a solution? How long do you have to see that play itself out again and again and again? Maybe it's something on a school board, at a hospital, over at City Hall. It doesn't matter the where of it all. It's when will you allow that holy disturbance inside of you make you stand up and say, it ends here, it ends now, it ends with me. You're challenged.